So we're talking about whole life and how whole life, it's a permanent insurance and it has the death component and then the cash value component. And so what is a universal life? Because that's also a sort of permanent insurance.
Universal life, the main difference is that it doesn't have a lot of guarantees. They have a guarantee, minimum guarantee, which can be 4 or 3. But also, the premium can go up and down, depending on what is happening with the market.
Okay.
So with the whole life, you have a guaranteed premium.
Okay.
If you say you are going to pay $100 for 1 month, mm-hmm. it's going to be for that for 20 or for forever. If you say you're going to pay 1,000 for a month, it's going to be like that. But that universal, it can change. It's flexible.
But isn't it the portion of universal that's flexible is your cash value? Because, you know, if they have a guarantee, some of them or most of them will have a guaranteed death benefit. So let's say you're getting insured for $50,000. That $50,000 stays there. And then the cash value, it's what goes up and down,
yes.
depending on how you invest it,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So with whole life, you don't have a control over where your money is invested. That's my understanding. But with universal, you have a control within certain guidelines where you want your money to be invested, the cash portion of your money.
Your cash portion of your money will be in stock market for universal. It's not going to be elsewhere. Whereas for whole life, they are so conservative in what they do. So there's that chance that, you know, it's going to somewhere that at the end of the day, they're not going to turn around. That's what happened in 2008 and 2009. People that have universal, they saw a loss in their cash value and it affected their death benefit. And it begins to call them that your policy is going to last. Instead of that one, you increase your premium. You know, they never told you your premium was guaranteed for universal.
Okay.
Or you decrease your debt benefit.
Yeah, but on the other hand too, if the market is doing very well, you know, it increases. Your cash value increases because you're now, instead of investing it in this 4%, I don't know what your company is, but I know like New York Life, it's like a 6% guarantee, right? So instead of investing it in 6% and you're investing in stock market, your cash value can also increase astronomically.
Yes.
So it goes both ways,
yes.
You know. You're risk averse.
We want to risk. We want to risk what is going to volatility of the stock market. Just for instance, somebody has a policy that's universal. And for the past 10 years, they mm-hmm. invested almost 130,000 in premium.
Okay.
And the death benefit is 600. Most of the time, the death benefit does not increase for universal.
Okay.
So when the collapse happened in 2008,
okay.
they now call you in your office. And they said, oh, we're sorry to tell you that your cash value has dropped from to 60,000.
Right.
And you tell them, what do you mean 60,000? I've already invested 130 to this.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's because of the market.
Right.
So, you know, your policy is going to lapse. It's either you increase your premium or decrease your death benefit. But for all life, even with the fall in the market, whatever is happening in the market is not going to affect your thing, your policy. You're not going to be called tomorrow and say, increase your premium. You're not going to be called tomorrow and say, decrease your death benefit.
That's
so
true.
The beauty of the whole life is always there.
Yeah, it is. It is. Okay, so just so, you know, I have a little bit of insurance background. So so I kind of understand.
I know that with the questions you're asking me.
So that the audience understands that, you know, I have a background of some background in insurance. It's been a long time. So that's why you're the expert. But so with the universal, right, you can choose to stay with what you guys are doing, or you can choose to say, I want this to be in the stock market, right?
Yes, you can choose, but most of the time, it's not your mutual fund or it's not your stocks and bond where they can move things around mm-hmm. individually.
This yeah, within certain guidelines.
Yeah, it depends on what the company wants to do
yeah.
with that policy.
Yeah.
So that is why it's yeah. different.
And the reason why you get a kind of like a cash call, a margin call with your universal life is because even though you're paying this premium, right, you stop paying premium. Some of the investment, the interest you're earning from this investment is also funding your premium.
Yes, it depends if you have paid for a long time,
okay.
if you have enough cash value,
okay.
they can now call you
mm-hmm.
and said, okay, we can take some cash. You remember, it's going to affect the debt benefit. Right. And the market must really be doing well for them to say, okay, stop it, I want you to use the cash value. But after some time, mm-hmm. there will not be cash there for you to pay your policy.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful with universal, very careful. You have to keep an eye.
Yeah, so we have to eventually talk about the variable universal and variable life, you know, that's all this component. So would you say that if you're not risk averse, you know, if you're older, maybe you're in your 60s, that it's not advisable for you to go into the universal? It's easier for you to just stay in the whole life.
Excellent.
Right?
Yes.
But if you're younger, if you have time.
If you're younger and you have time, I would also like you to, because when you're younger, you're already in the market with your 401k.
Okay.
You're already in market with your mutual fund,
okay.
with your stock, with okay. a lot of investment. You're already in the market.
Right.
Why do you want to now put your life insurance that is in a risky, something that's not is predictable?
Well, see, that leads me to one thing that, I mean, at least I tried to practice that, whether it made sense or not, it's besides the point. But if you have enough discipline, you can actually bifurcate your money. You buy term, because term is cheaper, and then you go out and you invest the other amount, as opposed to buying universal. Now, that's not like it's, I'm not advising that, but if you're that disciplined, most people are not that disciplined. So it's easier for you to just kind of get this policy, right? But so if you're risk averse, you don't have to stick with whole life. You can stick with universal and try to get your money work more for you.
You know, it depends on the situation.
Exactly.
And I want people to know that it's not just taking the phone and calling somebody, I'm 52 and my health is excellent, I want to buy a 1 million, what is the premium?
Yeah.
That is not like that. You're not getting the best advice.
Right.
I really want to sit down and look at your unique situation. Look at your goals. Look at your objective. Are you still married? Is your house paid? All those things. We do a proper job. It's not just.
But you kind of make me remember one thing. You talked about somebody calling you and saying, I'm in good health. So if you're in good health, if you're not in good health, what is the better route to go? Is it going through universal? Because, you know, kind of the underwriting between healthy and not healthy.
I will tell you one thing. The best financial vehicle in this world is life insurance. All the major banks, everything have life insurance, the executive, because I will tell you a story, and I've told some people. Walt Disney, that started the Disneyland, when people did not believe in his dream,
okay.
and he went to banks to borrow him money,
mm-hmm.
and they said, no, we don't believe in your dream.
Mm-hmm.
What do you have? Of course, he said, I don't have enough cash. But they said, I have a life value. Of course, he said, it has enough cash. I said, oh, you have a life value? Of course, it must be a big one.
Yeah.
They said, okay, that can be in the collateral for what you want to do. And he decided he has enough cash value. I said, we take that and we release our millions to you,
because
we know if anything happens to you, we can have that. With universal and all those things, you can come up. If you say you have a whole life, it's the best leverage for you.
How does that work if he didn't designate them as the beneficiary?
Now he's going to. That's it. Of course, when immediately we said that, we want to
take it,
he have to call us and we have to change the beneficiary.
Beneficiary, okay.
Because many people that want to start business do not know. Recently, I met a dentist in my church. And she said, Toyin, wow, you guys really are doing a good job. Do you know my financial advisor called me up and said, years ago, you bought this life insurance, all life insurance, because you wanted to start your practice and you didn't have enough money.
Okay.
And they advised you go and get your whole life insurance.
Yeah.
And this is donkey years, 30 years ago. My advisor come and say, you have enough cash there.
Yeah.
Oh, he said, Toyin, you guys are doing a good job. Say, no.
when
I had that call, say, what? I have enough cash. He said,
that
is the beauty. And what is it? It's the leverage of your money.
Yeah.
Leveraging your money is the most important thing. Let's say you're talking about investment.
Okay.
If you today have 500,000 or 200,000 and said to him, I don't want to buy that life insurance. I want to go and put it in stock. I want to go and buy a house.
Yeah.
I said, go ahead.
Yeah.
God forbid, nobody knows tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I said, Nonny or anybody or Mr. B, my advice to you is that you have 500,000. Let me give you advice. I know you believe in stock market.
you believe in your house, buying a house.
Yeah.
I want to take $300,000 and buy a life insurance that will give a debt benefit of $1 million.
Okay.
And you take $200,000 to go and buy your house and mutual fund. And God forbid, tomorrow they call me, Mr. B passed away. Wow, what happened? I said, oh, he gave us $300,000 as a debt benefit of $1 million.
Okay.
I'll be happy to write you the check tomorrow. Can you come to my office?
Okay.
Remember, it's $200,000. But the house he bought or the mutual fund, what would they give him back?
Well,
$250,000 or $200,000.
But it depends, right? It depends because he just died, you know. But if you were 20 years old and you invested.
Live forever.
And you invested the same amount of money in stock as insurance, more than likely you'll come up higher. So, as much
you
as
cannot
insurance,
come up higher because of the volatility of the market.
Yeah,
the market will be going up and down. The house you bought, I pray that you've got somebody to rent it for that long. You have mortgage insurance, you have property tax, you have all those things to do with.
That's why I think life insurance is one way of financial planning.
Yes.
But there are other ways to do financial planning, including stock market, mutual funds, real estate. There's other kinds that you can do. But I do understand that life insurance, especially if you have a whole life, since the debt benefit is not taxable,
excellent.
You know, so that's still good. That's still good. And it doesn't substitute your 401k plan.
Yeah, let me talk about tax. Whole life insurance has a lot of
She's going to talk about tax.
I know, that's
a tax specialist.
Yeah, I know, that's your specialty. A whole life policy has a lot of tax advantage. One, your cash value will go tax deferred. So you're not paying any tax on your cash. Number two,
is it tax deferred or is it not taxable? Because if it's something is tax deferred, just like your 401k, eventually when you take it out, then you pay tax.
Yes. It's not taxable.
Okay.
Right. When it's not taxable, then when you begin to take a loan, it's not going to be taxable the way we are going to take it.
Yeah.
Let's say you invest $200,000 for over 20 years in the policy.
Okay.
And you come back to me. $100,000 is what you invest.
Okay.
The premium is going to be $300,000.
Okay.
Your debt benefit for whole life does not stay at the same point. It grows too. So I said, oh, Tony, you know what? How much cash value? I said, well, for the past 10 years, you have invested $200,000.
Mm-hmm.
Your cash value has gone to $300,000. Your debt benefits has also increased. Oh, I would like to take $250,000 out from that.
Why? So let's be practical here. So practically, I know what, for your company, Mass Mutual, if you have a whole life, how long do you pay your premium for?
Yes, if you have a low life, you can pay, there is what is called life 10. That means after 10 years,
okay.
You can stop paying your premium.
Okay.
You are done with paying premium, but your insurance will be for life.
For life, okay. Is it 10? Is that
we
okay?
We have 10, we have 20,
okay.
And we have 100. For the 100, we design it for some people for risk management, because
okay.
For 100 you will get a very big face value.
Okay.
And if you are still not, we are still, your house is not fully paid, you have children in college,
okay.
You may encourage that, but it does not mean that you pay for 100 years.
Okay.
If after 10 years you want to stop paying, you just give me a call.
Okay.
And say, Tony, I don't want to pay insurance.
But you have to pay for that 10 years, right?
No, even for the 10-year period one, you can say after 2 years, I don't want to pay.
And it stays there.
And it stays in force.
You don't cash it out.
You can surrender your policy.
Okay.
If you want to surrender after 2 years, that's something.
That's a different limit.
Yeah.
Because there's surrender value, right?
Yeah, you can surrender your
cash
value.
Your cash value is not equal to your surrender value.
Yeah, because there are certain things. So there is,
oh my gosh, I'm still remembering all these lingos.
Yeah, you can. But before we go on, Noni, for working people, because you said there are other investment, other things you can do, I'm particularly interested in young kids that are starting, or just graduated from college,
okay.
Or they are young professionals, like they are doctors, they are CPA, or they are business owners, and
yes.
They have kids. There are things that we do for them called a good planning. And that means when you start working, we want you to sign into any qualified fund, like a 401k, 403b, we want you to sign in. After signing in that office, your retirement, because one day, that money is going to stop. Then we want you to have a life insurance. After having life insurance, we want you to start thinking about buying a house, real estate. Then we want you to start thinking about investment. And also what we advise people is that Do not depend only on your salary. Get a business going.
Well, it depends because, you know, when you're advising someone, that it depends on what they want out of their life, you know, and what their company allows. For example, I used to work for a company that wouldn't let me do anything unless it's approved. If it's non-profit, then I can do it. So that's kind of like a tricky thing because it's all based on individual and your circumstances. But let's kind of go back to the insurance. So once you pay like your 10 years, then you're done.
Yes.
And then for the rest of your life, you have insurance and you're probably also increasing your cash value, which you can borrow out of. Okay. So now we've talked about whole life, we've talked about universal. So there are other types. Before I go back into talking about variable, let's talk about the survivorship insurance.
Survivorship insurance means that most likely, most of the time, it's a couple.
It's a couple. So it's more than one person.
It's more than one person.
Yeah, okay. And couples do that a lot.
Yeah, and couples do that a lot for a lot of reasons.
Right.
Two people, we own a policy, mm-hmm. and we pay the death benefit at second to die. So if you have a married couple and the husband pass away,
yeah.
we will not pay, or the wife pass away, we will not pay that benefit on the other person.
But we also have survivorship where it's first to die.
Depending on how it's settled, there are a lot of riders that we can put, a lot of conditions. But most of the time, a survivorship policy means that the first to die, there's nothing going to be paid. It's the second one. And most of the time is used because why estate tax is due. We want to have enough cash, which we're going to talk about. You know, estate taxes. Many people don't need it, but a lot of us Nigerians, we begin to see as I go around that they will need to pay estate tax.
Okay, so let's kind of hold on to that thought, and we'll come back to the survivorship insurance because that's really important.